Blessed William Davies, priest and publisher of the first book printed in Wales. By Joseph Kelly.
Te Deum laudamus, te Dominum confitemur, te Eternum Patrem omnis terra veneratur.
We praise you, God, we acknowledge you, Lord, Eternal Father, all the earth worships you. Recited aloud at the Assizes by Father William Davies and his friends after he was condemned to death. The chapel inside Beaumaris Castle. The Blessed William Davies Guild, a publisher's promise is fulfilled. Time spent in the sacred silence of Beaumaris Castle Chapel, or in one of the tiny, damp cells in its notorious dark alley, recalling the work and sacrifice of Father William Davies and his fellow priests, is enough to put the troubles of anyone's day into perspective. In recent years, this place has become my refuge whenever time was needed to reflect, or to seek inspiration, and I always promised that one day I would acknowledge Father Davies by writing a little book on his life, and maybe even somehow republish the text of itself. When it was announced in the autumn of 2009 that Pope Benedict XVI was going to visit Britain the following year, the excitement was immense. Sadly, he was unable to visit Wales, so there were many suggestions about how a Welsh dimension could be incorporated into the visit. The result was the creation of the magnificent mosaic of St. David in Westminster Cathedral, designed by Welsh artist Ivor Davies. The mosaic was to be blessed by Pope Benedict with holy water from St. Nonswell in Pembrokeshire, and a candle, taken from the hand of Our Lady of the Taper, Cardigan to Westminster, was to be lit as well. It was also felt that special gifts from the people of Wales could be presented at this point, and a number of suggestions were made. As the distributor of the official papal visit mass books, I was very fortunate to be present at these early planning meetings, and it seemed an obvious moment to mention the long-forgotten Blessed William Davies story. One thing led to another, and in January 2010 I was privileged to be able to commission the National Library of Wales, Aberystwyth, to create a specially bound facsimile of the original book, as a gift to His Holiness from the Catholic universe, its readers, and the people of Wales. The task was by no means straightforward, as it involved dismantling one of the most prized treasures of the National Library of Wales in order to produce the facsimile. The finished book and its presentation case were finished just a few days before the visit, and were only delivered to Westminster Cathedral the night before the papal mass. Bishop Edwin Regan of Wrexham made the presentation, and Pope Benedict seemed delighted with this unusual and special gift, which now resides on display in the Vatican Museums. It was a great honor that His Holiness acknowledged the significance of this famous little book during his UK visit, both in terms of the perilous history of the Elizabethan period, the dedication and sacrifice of Father Davies and his colleagues, and the importance of the book to the Welsh nation, and to Welsh Catholics in particular. And there the story might have ended, but for the year of faith, and everyone wanting to take further the many inspiring ideas that the papal visit gave rise to. In the introduction to the author appropriately makes a plea to the people of Wales not to be fearful of practicing their Catholic faith in dangerous times, but to put all worries aside and to trust in God. He also pledges the book, and his missionary task to train priests in North Wales, to the service of the Holy Father. It's not known for certain who wrote the text of the first book to be printed on Welsh soil, but Father Davies was a key member of the small group of recusants who produced and distributed it, at great peril to themselves, from a secret cave on the Little Orm, Llandudno, in North Wales. The story of how he did this, and the legend of him throwing the printing press into the sea as a diversion to allow his friends to escape, for me made Father Davies the perfect patron and inspiration for the UK's leading Catholic publishing house. We also gave a lot of thought to the wish of Father Davies to promote the message of the faith throughout these islands, so it also seemed appropriate to lend his name to our Guild of Parish Helpers, who work so tirelessly to support our clergy, and to encourage the reading of our Catholic publications across the UK and Ireland. We can all be grateful that long before us there were those determined Catholics like Father Davies who strove to ensure that the good news of the Catholic faith was passed on. Today we are all firmly a part of that historic tradition, a link in a chain of evangelization that stretches back through the centuries to the apostles themselves. I do hope this brief guide brings you closer to the spirit of Blessed William Davies, and helps to enhance your experience and appreciation of the Catholic faith. If it does, then I have finally been able to honor my own little pledge to Father Davies. The Dangerous Road to God. The Parish Church at Landerlow Yn Rose. Father Davies was born nearby, and his protectors, the Pew family, are buried here. The memorial to Blessed William Davies in Our Lady Queen of Martyrs Catholic Church in Beaumaris. William Davies was born sometime around 1556, in a small hamlet called Crows Yn Areas, which today is a popular, leafy valley and suburb nestling just to the west of Colwyn Bay. Little is known of his origins, though it is believed he may have been the grandson of a prominent local harpist by the name of David Nantglen. A list of recusants in the area from 1587 points to the possibility that he may have been the son of Catherine and William de O.R. Groves, and had a sister called Ellen. Nothing is known of Davies' education, but it's a reasonable assumption that he was the William Davies referred to in the alumni Oxonienses who matriculated at St. Edmund's Hall on January 10, 1575, and obtained his degree in 1578. More certain is the fact that he arrived at the Jesuit seminary at Reims on April 6, 1582, along with three fellow Welsh students, Humphrey Jones and brothers called Lloyd, sadly none of whom finished their training. The progress of William Davies can be seen thanks to the Douay Diary, a record of seminarians maintained after the seminary had moved from Douay to Reims due to the prevailing political situation. The diary records that William was ordained on the eve of Passion Sunday, April 1585. It was certainly not a good time to have become a Catholic priest. Just a week earlier, the persecution of Catholics by Elizabeth I had reached its climax when she gave royal assent to Act 27 Elies.C.2, specifically an act against Jesuits, seminary priests, and other such like disobedient persons. This statute, under which some 187 the English martyrs suffered, made it high treason for any Jesuit or any seminary priest to be in England at all, and a felony for anyone to harbour or relieve them. Undeterred, William Davies set out for North Wales on June 6, just 3 months later. Throughout his studies he had begged his superiors to ordain him urgently so that he could return to his homeland. No doubt his fervour had been inspired by the great Jesuit restorationist, Father Persons, who had declared during a visit to England in 1580 that no part of the country was in greater need of priests than Wales. Although several earlier missionaries, including one John Bennett in 1582, had tried to bring the faith to North Wales, the English influence on the area remained dominant. The busy trading routes across the region to and from Ireland, and the increasing loyalty of local landowners to the Crown, made life for a Catholic in North Wales particularly dangerous. By the late 16th century, the Croydon Peninsula, modern-day Llandudno, had become one of the last refuges of the faith in Caernarfonshire, and even the few remaining recusant families were finding it difficult to support themselves and the few priests brave enough to minister to them. Such were the dangers that, not surprisingly, scant evidence has survived to tell us of the activities of Father Davies during this period. The only clear glimpse comes from the writings of the Queen herself, who was seemingly incensed to learn that certain recusants and other obstinate persons in religion were clearly flouting her laws. The local magistrate was reprimanded severely, and was accused of negligence. It may well have been that he harbored Catholic sympathies, but he was ordered on pain of his life to seek out and arrest any known recusants, and to do his utmost to prevent or break up the unlawful assembly of Catholics, the Jesuits, etc. Act 1584, 27 Elies.1, c.2, was an act of the Parliament of England during the English Reformation. The act commanded all Roman Catholic priests to leave the country in 40 days or they would be punished for high treason, unless within the 40 days they swore an oath to obey the Queen. Those who harboured them, and those who knew of their presence and failed to inform the authorities would be fined and imprisoned for felony. Anyone else who was, or was later trained as, a Jesuit overseas had to return to England within 6 months, and then within 2 days of arriving swear to submit to the Queen and also take the oath required by the Act of Supremacy 1558. Failure to do so was treason. Any person who did take the oath was forbidden from coming within 10 miles of the Queen for 10 years, unless they had her personal written permission. Again, failure to observe this requirement was treason. The execution of a Catholic priest under the Act in 1594 became the subject of a court case 401 years later. In 1995, a church applied to the Consistory Court in Durham for a faculty, planning permission, to display a memorial plaque on the church door, in memory of the dead priest. However, even though the 1584 Act had been repealed long ago, the priest's conviction had not been quashed, and so the court could not permit it. However, in 2008, the Oxford Consistory Court, presided over by the same judge, declined to follow that case as a precedent. It shall not be lawful for any Jesuit to come into, be, or remain in any part of this realm, or any other of Her Highness's dominions. Elizabeth I. Robert Pugh and Place Penryn. Robert Pugh of Penryn Croydon was a prominent and influential local landowner who maintained a remarkable double life. He was a renowned barrister and leading member of his local community, yet he was also a devout Catholic who helped and supported Father Davies on his mission. It was 8 years before the work of Father Davies came to the attention of the authorities, a remarkably lengthy and successful ministry in times steeped in danger, mistrust, government spies, and deadly betrayals. From records abroad, we know that Father Davies sent many young men from North Wales to the continent to be trained as priests. Though no local records survive, we can be certain that he was also very active in the North Wales countryside, saying Mass and administering the sacraments, as well as preaching and giving words of comfort and inspiration whenever he could. Many recusant families protected and concealed priests at this terrible time of persecution, and Father Davies was fortunate in that he had befriended a sympathetic local dignitary, Robert Pugh. Pugh came from an ancient Welsh family, the second son of Hugh A. P. Renault of Penryn. He was also the favoured nephew of another Robert Pugh, who was variously a sheriff, MP, and JP. No doubt inspired by his illustrious uncle, our Robert Pugh became a lawyer, entering the Middle Temple in 1567. His uncle also helped him socially, introducing him to his future wife, Jane Bulkeley, a staunch Catholic and the daughter of Sir Richard Bulkeley of Beaumaris, who was at the time head of one of the wealthiest families in Wales. In October of 1582, a writ of outlawry was issued against Robert and Jane Pugh, and the High Sheriff, John Griffith, was ordered to record all the family's property and possessions. The sheriff, however, seemed less than enthusiastic about the task, and didn't take action until the following summer, 1583. In the same year, records show that they were being reported by the Bishop of St. Asaph as recusants who had refused to attend Church of England services. It's uncertain how or when Father Davies and Robert Pugh came to form their remarkable friendship, but they lived within a few miles of each other, so must have been acquainted from a fairly early time in their lives. Robert's home was Place Penryn, in its day a remote manor house tucked away discreetly between several steeply wooded valleys and the sea, in what would have been a fairly remote and rarely visited location. It is clear the house was not only a home to Father Davies, but formed the centre from which he conducted his missionary work across North Wales. Today much of the house still survives, pictured above, though alterations and additions are equally evident. It is a popular local pub and restaurant whose low, heavily timbered ceilings and great fireplaces still vividly evoke what must have been the cosy and intimate atmosphere of the hall in Father Davies' day. There is a stone with a Christogram, dated 1590, above the fireplace in the Tudor bar which commemorates Father Davies' stay, and the hall is steeped in all sorts of histories and legends, including a remarkable find made by the Royal Commission on Ancient Monuments in Wales and Monmouthshire in 1910. On removing the whitewash from a partition wall in a room above the Great Hall, experts found a series of wall paintings, the most astonishing of which is the figure of a bearded man with a long drooping mustache, his right hand on his breast, and his left raised with the forefinger pointing upwards. Around the picture in large letters is the moving inscription, "The Word of God is life to the soul." Most likely the inscription comes from De Imitatione Christi by Thomas à Kempis, in which he refers to the two essentials in his life, Holy Communion and the Scriptures, "The Word of God is light to my soul." There was another figure and inscription on the wall, but this is all but lost completely, save for a brief fragment, or, self. It has been suggested that the second fresco draws on the opening chapter of the Confessions of Saint Augustine, in which there is a well-known sentence. "Thou hast made us for thyself, and our hearts are restless till they repose in thee." Both of these devotional books were very popular amongst all Christians during the Elizabethan period, so the presence of such quotations in the house would have served Catholics well, whilst arousing little suspicion amongst visiting Protestants. After William Davies' execution, it is believed that the pews acquired his hand and concealed it in a hole behind the house. After the departure of the pews, among other things left behind was an old trunk. When this was opened, a withered hand was found inside, supposedly that of Father Davies. "Thou hast made us for thyself, and our hearts are restless till they repose in thee." Saint Augustine of Hippona. An early Victorian postcard of Penarhyn Old Hall gives a clear picture of the range of the original building, much of which dates back to Father Davies' time. The story of the imposing western face of the Little Orme, Llandudno, from where Father Davies and his friends produced in a secret cave. Inside the hill without much fear, with the wooden press the men are printing the pleasant book, with much praise throughout Christendom, the Mall Penarhyn, by William Pugh. Disguising the author of a popish and traitorous book. The Christian Mirror, in which every Christian may perceive the root and beginning of all spiritual good, that is, how to serve God by loving Him and fearing Him above everything else and how to cast aside everything that is a hindrance to that end. The first part, setting forth the service of God by loving Him. Saint Charles Borromeo, Cardinal Archbishop of Milan, had strong links with the Welsh missionary priests. The story of the Christian Mirror gives a fascinating insight into the perilous lives led by Catholics during this turbulent period in history. This historic little devotional book was also the first book ever to be published on Welsh soil. It is said that Father William Davies lived in Pugh's house from the time of his arrival in Wales, but that an unknown event in mid-1586 forced the family and their friends to flee, seeking refuge nearby in a cave on the Little Orme. It is very likely that the event was the death in May of Sir Henry Sidney, Lord President of the Council in the Marches. Sidney had long been suspected of harboring Catholic sympathies, and had been censured directly by the Queen for failing to enforce the Jesuit Act. Lord Walsingham, one of the Queen's principal secretaries of state, had also warned Sidney that he was being watched. Within just a fortnight of his death, the Privy Council had written a letter to the Council in the Marches, condemning the inabilities of local magistrates to stamp out Catholic gatherings and masses. Their letter made it clear in no uncertain terms that any such occurrences were to be suppressed and the offenders punished, a demand that no one could ignore. It was probably in the wake of this that Pugh and his group decided to quit Plas Penrhyn and seek refuge in a cave in the Rhylidon Cliffs on Little Orme's Head. However, not content to be merely refugees, the group set about creating various means for promoting the message of the Catholic faith, including the building of a printing press. The principal account of these dark days comes from a poem Mall Penarhyn written by Robert Pugh's grandson, William Pugh. William tells us that there were 8 people in the devout band, of whom 3 are named directly, Robert Pugh, Hugh Thomas, a relation who had been evicted from his property, and Father William Davies. Amongst many things, William Pugh describes a typical day in the cave, where each person has a specific task: one is roasting meat, one is brewing, and another is even attempting to make a clock. The center of everything, though, is the wooden printing press on which they are producing the first book to have been printed on Welsh soil. Books printed in the 16th and 17th centuries as part of the Counter-Reformation movement had to be printed abroad or on secret presses since Catholic printing was prohibited. The title page of proclaims that it was printed in 1585 at Rouen by the heirs of Iathris Favo. In the preface, the book is attributed in the printed text to one G.R. of Milan. At one time this G.R. was assumed to be the Catholic grammarian Gruffid Robert, before 1532, after 1598, a long-time resident of that city and a scholar well-known amongst Welsh Catholic exiles. Robert, or Roberts, was a close friend of St. Charles Borromeo, Cardinal Archbishop of Milan, and lived for many years at the Cardinal's residence. However, the style of the language is completely different from that of Gruffid Robert but is closely akin to that of the missionary priest and author Robert Gwynne, c. 1540-50, 1592-1604, a native of Lanna-Rmon near Pulheli. Some scholars believe that the G.R. of Milan attribution is a coded reference to Robert Gwynne, R.G. The second preface is signed R.S., and the location is Rouen. This could well be Roger Smith, a Welshman from St. Asaph who was a friend of Griffith Roberts in exile. R.S. says the book is the first volume in a four-part work by the great teacher of Milan and that he, Smith, had sent a manuscript copy of it to Wales, where it was so well received he had decided to have the first three parts printed at Rouen. There is also a curious and intriguing note that the printer had used English type, thus accounting for some of the slight peculiarities of spelling in the Welsh text. To the experienced researcher, the two prefaces and the rather over-elaborate explanations of the book's provenance hint strongly at a rather obvious attempt to disguise the book's actual printing place. We must also give considerable weight to William Pugh's poem, which is a near-contemporary account of the Orme printing venture. It does seem highly unlikely that William could have been mistaken in the title of the book being printed in the cave by his grandfather. The reference to English type would also point to the Orme. The work itself deals with the Catholic Church's teaching on the four last things, viz. Death, the Day of Judgment, Hell and Heaven. There is evidence that the complete text was in existence in manuscript by 1583-84 and that Robert Gwynne met the two English missionaries, Robert Persons and Edmund Campion, in 1580 to discuss means of overcoming the restrictions on Catholic printing. Only the first part of the text was ever printed, though the preface states that the intention was to print it in its entirety. The complete work survived in handwritten copies and one such copy, made by the scribe Llewellyn Sean, survives in Cardiff Library. Is a small, pocket book, obviously intended to be carried and concealed easily. Measuring just 5.5 by 4 inches, and 180 pages long, the typeface is English Gothic in style, and is remarkably well produced. The creative use of leading spaces, and the tightness of presentation in such a small typeface, puts it technically amongst the most well-produced books of the 16th century. A facsimile that delighted Pope during his 2010 visit. As Pope Benedict XVI was unable to visit Wales during his 2010 UK papal visit, we thought it might be a nice gesture to bring to him a special gift from the people of Wales. An facsimile of seemed like an obvious idea, but little could I have imagined that it would be such a complex, lengthy, and delicate undertaking. Thanks to the National Library of Wales in Aberystwyth, however, we were able to secure the services of their head of conservation, Julian Thomas, who is widely recognized as one of the world's leading conservators of ancient books. The biggest challenge that faced Julian in producing the facsimile was the physical size of the original book. It is only a small volume, designed to be hidden in a pocket or secret compartment. The first task was to get accurate digital images of every page, and this required very careful loosening and manipulation of the delicate, ancient bindings and spine. High-quality digital images were used to print inkjet copies on thin paper and these were then adhered back-to-back to make gatherings of leaves, said Julian. One of the most time-consuming processes was painting the edges of each leaf using acrylic paint to match the color of the original edge. The leaves were then bound in an identical manner to the library's 18th-century binding of the book. The final task was to select special leathers and gilding, in an effort to match the materials of the original book as closely as possible. The volume was covered in brown calfskin with a full gilt spine and with a dark red label lettered in gold, said Julian. It was an amazing and fascinating process, said Universe Managing Director Joseph Kelly. It was extraordinary to be able to see and handle the original book that had been published in the Little Orm Cave, and to have such a direct moment of connection with Father Davies, said Mr. Kelly. The binding was presented to the Pope by Bishop Edwin Regan of Wrexham during the unveiling of the Mosaic of St. David at the Papal Mass in Westminster Cathedral on September 18, 2010. To see Father Davies' little book put directly into the hands of the Holy Father was quite overwhelming. As he struggled in that dark and dangerous place, I'm sure Father Davies never imagined that, 400 years later, we'd be sharing his labors in such a dramatic way. Jesuit influence gave its reputation. The book commences, The Christian Mirror, in which every Christian may perceive the root and beginning of all spiritual good, that is, how to serve God by loving Him and fearing Him above everything else and how to cast aside everything that is a hindrance to that end. The first part, setting forth the service of God by loving Him. The first chapter makes an appeal to Christians to develop the ability and practice of mediation and prayer on the teachings of the Church which, the author states, is the chief reason he decided to write the book. In particular, the words are addressed to those who are Catholics but are not practicing their faith, in the belief that prayer and contemplation will deepen faith and understanding, and a desire to live a Christian life. The second chapter deals with the mysteries of the creation and the world in which we live. The reader is called upon to praise God for many material things, including food, shelter, and good health. The third chapter is the longest in the book, and deals with the central mysteries of the incarnation and redemption, which the writer says is the primary reason for loving God, and there is an extremely detailed and very moving explanation of the passion. The fourth and final chapter talks about last things, and the promise of eternal happiness and salvation that God gives us. From the later Cardiff manuscript, we can see that subsequent books would have dealt with sin and repentance, and the emptiness of the world's riches and possessions. What is perhaps most remarkable about the book is that it speaks to the reader in a plain, but profound, language, and one that rather unusually for the period translates into modern language very easily. The entire text is profoundly Catholic in its suppositions, but it's no theological text. It argues no doctrine, makes no defenses and, most significantly, makes no reference to the new and blasphemous doctrines of the Reformation. In style and structure, it is very well organized, and its systematic treatment of the key tenets of the Catholic faith during this early Counter-Reformation period reveal a marked Jesuit influence. It may not have the gravitas of other great Jesuit texts of the period, such as St. Francis de Sales' Introduction to the Devout Life, but its plain and easily understood language makes it equally significant. Clearly intended for a literate, but non-academic, readership, could well be summarized as one of the earliest attempts at a catechism of the Catholic Church. It is not known how many copies of the book were produced and distributed, but printing came to an abrupt end on April 14, 1587, when the cave was discovered. The story is told in a letter written just 2 days later by a local J.P., William Griffith of Caernarfon, to John Whitgift, Archbishop of Canterbury. The Griffith letter states that the cave was by the sea, and that a local informer had spotted smoke rising from the headland, whereupon he went to investigate and saw a dozen or so Jesuits, seminaries, and recusants around the cave, some of them armed and guarding the cave. Sir Thomas Mostyn of Glodeath, the local magistrate, was informed, and gathered a militia of around 40 men to investigate. However, the troop decided not to enter the cave, as the entrance was dangerously narrow and dark. Instead, a guard was posted overnight, and the militiamen returned in the morning. However, they found the occupants had fled by another, secret exit, and the printing press had been thrown into the sea. The Griffith letter states that leaden type was found strewn along the shore, which the aforesaid seminaries and recusants upon their flight did cast into the sea, and I have sent some of them unto your grace by his messenger. On entering the cave, they found that the walls had been lined with boards, and an altar decorated with wooden panels was also found. No arrests were made, and Sir Thomas was reprimanded severely for his slow actions and the decision to wait until morning before acting. Later in 1587, the government discovered a secret press at the home of the doctor and scholar Zion David Rees, 1534c.1619, in Brecon, and it has been suggested that the intention may have been to print the remainder of the text here. Today, only four copies of are extant, three of which are imperfect. One perfect copy survives, and is one of the great printed treasures of the National Library of Wales in Aberystwyth. You can view a full digital image of the surviving copy of on the National Library of Wales website, in the Digital Mirror section, www.llgc.org.uk. John Whitgift, Archbishop of Canterbury, was a bitter opponent of the private printing press. The trial and death of Sir Di. Thy yoke, O Lord, is sweet and thy burden is light. Father William Davies. In March 1591, the authorities finally apprehended Father Davies, or Sir Di as he was known locally. He was arrested at Holyhead, where he had been trying to secure passage for three students and a boy on a ship bound for Ireland, from where they were intending to travel to the great seminary at Valladolid. Also arrested was one of his fellow priests, Robert A. P. Hugh. Somehow Robert A. P. Hugh managed to escape, much to the annoyance of the local council, and the Bishop of Bangor, who instructed that the remaining prisoners should be brought to trial with all possible haste. However, the prisoners were held in Beaumaris Castle for 4 months, in the worst dungeons. Known as the Black Alley, the dungeons were small latrine compartments in a corridor deep inside the castle walls. Few of the cells had windows, just a small chimney leading up to the open sky far above, and the cells were directly over the rancid castle sewers. We are fortunate that a detailed account of the various trials and eventual martyrdom of Father Davies survives. Firstly, we have the martyr's letter, a lengthy, handwritten document that today resides in the Jesuit archives in London. A note on the back of the document reads, "Mr. Davies, the priest's letter, I know not whether of his own hand." The second record comes from an account given by one of his fellow priests, who fled to Valladolid after the martyrdom and recounted the life of Father Davies to Bishop Yeps, who recorded it in his book,
Historia particular de la persecución en Inglaterra.
Of the original arrest, we also have a fascinating surviving narrative from William Robbins, one of the men arrested with Father Davies at Holyhead. Robbins says the group were examined at Beaumaris, where they were asked if they had any religious objects such as an Agnus Dei, or blessed medals or rosary beads. They were also asked if they had received any letters from seminaries on the continent, or had messages of any kind from the Pope. Being in possession of religious objects meant confiscation of your property, and having a letter from the Pope was high treason. Nothing was found on the prisoners, so they were next asked if they would attend a Protestant service and take the oath of supremacy, acknowledging Queen Elizabeth as the one, true head of the Church. All refused, and were subjected to several days of further intense questioning and threats upon their lives. Eventually, Father Davies and his group were thrown back into the dark alley, to await their trial and sentence. Despite their confinement, they managed to collect together materials to celebrate Mass, and the governor became increasingly lenient, allowing them to go to the chapel to say Mass each day, before returning to their cells. Something of a religious community developed, and many came from miles around to receive advice and support. Other ministers came too, to argue theology and to discuss the scriptures with Father Davies. Regular confessions were held, with people traveling up to 80 miles to receive the Eucharist. On several occasions, benefactors bribed guards and pleaded with Father Davies to escape, but he always refused, saying that his mission was to stay at the castle. The final days of Father Davies began on Wednesday, July 18, 1593, when he was eventually brought to the bar at Beaumaris and the charges against him were read out. When asked by the justice why he should not be condemned, Father Davies replied,
"Sir, I acknowledge the contents of the bill to be true, which is no more, as I understand, than that I am a priest, but for the statute whereupon this was framed, I was never acquainted therewith. and therefore I shall have mercy and the favor of the law, as others have had being in my case.
It is true, replied the justice, that some priests have been banished, but the most part executed, which thou dost well deserve, because thou art so stubborn, that thou wouldst not reveal, for anything that was done to thee, either the parties or the places wherein thou didst use thy trade, nor anything else to Her Majesty's commodity. Whereupon he condemned Father Davies. As he was hauled away, Father Davies could be heard reciting loudly the
Te Deum Laudamus.
He was thrown once again into the black alley, where he devoted his few remaining days to prayer and contemplation, and to comforting his colleagues. According to the Yep's account, all his friends that came to visit him, he did so replenish with comfort, that howsoever they came to him, they returned merrily. For such as were Catholics, he hoped he should meet with them merrily again, for his own father, or such as were not, nor yet would not be Catholics, he bid them farewell forever. When any would tell him that he hoped he should be reprieved, he would wax very sad and heavy, as contrawise, when he were told that he must be executed, he would be most merry and pleasant. Such was the popularity of Father Davies that, come the time of his execution, no one could be found to perform the ghastly deed. Eventually two prisoners were brought secretly from the jail in Chester, and were kept in hiding in a barn until the fateful day. The chapel, Beaumaris Castle, here Father William Davies and the men he was training for the priesthood celebrated Mass each day. The chapel remains in occasional use. Begun in 1295, Beaumaris was the last and largest of King Edward I's Welsh fortifications. Today it is a World Heritage Site, and the chapel and prisoner cells remain intact. http://www.cadw.wales.gov.uk for details of visiting hours. The townspeople refused to allow the sheriff to erect a gallows anywhere on town land, so this had to be done within the castle walls. On the morning of his execution, July 27, Father Davies prepared various mementos for his friends to persist in the Catholic faith, and passed them out through a crevice in his cell wall, saying eventually, "Now let them come when they will, I am ready for them." His arms were bound with a cord and he was set upon a cart, and a boy was ordered to drive the horse forward. The boy refused, saying, "I am well content to be hanged with this man with all my heart, but drive the horse I will not, do what you will." For his courage, the boy was released. At the place of execution, Father Davies was allowed to pray on his knees for a long while, until he was overheard saying the Ave Maris Stella, at which point the Protestant preacher, a man called Burgess, ordered the executioner to dispatch Father Davies without further delay. In what seems to have been a desperate last effort to save Father Davies, the local deputy sheriff intervened, asking him what he thought of the Queen, God give her a long, prosperous reign, and grace to die a member of the Catholic Church, came the firm reply. As he climbed the scaffold, Father Davies bade a final farewell to Wales. This island, Anglesey, was called in the old time the Dark Island, the which name it never better deserved than at this present. But I beseech God that the blood which I am brought hither innocently to shed, may give a light unto it of that faith which it hath received above 1,000 years agone. Then taking the halter, he kissed it and put it around his neck, saying, Thy yoke, O Lord, is sweet and thy burden light. The latter was turned, and Father Davies closed his fists hard, and thus they remained until he was dead, when his hands opened wide, and Father William Davies passed to his eternal reward. His body was then disemboweled, and he was beheaded and quartered. The head was set on top of his prison cell, two of his quarters were hung in Beaumaris Castle, one in Conwy Castle, and the fourth at Serwies. A messenger took the martyr's blood-stained cassock and clothes back to the prison to sell them to his companions. By chance he placed the garments on the very table which Davies had used as an altar, at the very time between 8 and 9 o'clock at which he used to say Mass. Those who came fell to their knees and kissed the relics, before taking them away for safe keeping before the messenger returned. The garments were divided, and portions given to many local Catholics. The cassock was preserved in its entirety and was, for many years, worn with great devotion under the vestments of priests saying Mass. Fr. William Davies was one of the 85 martyrs of England and Wales beatified by Pope John Paul II on November 22, 1987. Referring to the clergy among the list, he said, they wished only to feed their people with the bread of life and with the word of the gospel. To do so meant risking their lives. But for them this price was small compared to the riches they could bring to their people in the holy sacrifice of the Mass. Pray to the living God for benefits through the intercession of the saints. This island was called in the old time the Dark Island, the which name it never better deserved than at this present. But I beseech God that the blood which I am brought hither innocently to shed, may give a light unto it of that faith which it hath received above 1,000 years agone. Father William Davies. A secret press in a ruined chapel. The very account of the life of Father William Davies states that the printing press cave, in which all was produced, was destroyed during quarrying works on the Little Orme at the time of the First World War. However, the cave has survived, though its exact location remains a closely guarded secret. The Little Orme is now in part a national bird sanctuary, and today the cave can only be visited safely with full climbing equipment, being perched 80 feet below the summit and some 300 feet above a sheer drop to the swirling, tidal sea. With an entrance passage only 2 feet high, you have to crawl for some 7 feet before the cave opens out into a 12 feet square space, which today is the home of wild animals and numerous seabirds. No light penetrates the cave, but a 15 feet high natural limestone chimney provides ventilation and, as we know from our story, an alternative means of escape. The chimney also confirms the account of the discovery of the cave, from where smoke was seen rising mysteriously from the steep hillside. The cave was explored in 1961 by Douglas B. Haig of the Royal Commission on Ancient Monuments for Wales, who said that he was strongly inclined to believe that the cave had been in use in the late 16th century. Under 18 inches of modern floor debris, he found depressions which he described as looking like the imprints of floor joists, which he said could have supported a Gutenberg press, as illustrated above. His findings were confirmed a decade later by Melvin Davies, an archaeologist with the Nature Conservancy Council, who also observed the floor depressions. No doubt time and tide will have literally obliterated any remains of the famous printing press, but hidden on the floor of the cave may still be fragments of type. Perhaps one day experts will conduct a detailed survey, and physical evidence might finally be uncovered to confirm that was printed in this desolate place. In a field right next to Place Penryn, buried under a shroud of dense undergrowth, lie the ruins of the ancient chapel of Our Lady of Penryn. Last used for public worship in the 1930s, it is mentioned as early as 1535 with a Marian connection, and would undoubtedly have been a place where Father Davies worshipped and prayed. Although the roof timbers have collapsed, the owners of Place Penryn are still hoping to restore the chapel to its former glory. To their credit, they have removed and preserved the stained glass and decorated stonework. You can see the stained glass in illuminated panels behind the pub bar. A gift from Pope Nicholas. In 1535, the chapel was described intriguingly as
Libera Capella Beate Mariae de Penryn.
A libera capella being a royal chapel outside the jurisdiction of the ordinary, or local bishop. Another source states that Pope Nicholas assigned to it 3/4 of the tithes of Penryn. If this is Pope Nicholas IV, 1227-1292, who carried out a detailed valuation of all English and Welsh parish churches and prebends, a chapel from this earlier period may even have existed on the site. God reward you for your goodness towards us, and make us worthy to be heard for you, as our duty is to pray. Commend me, I pray, to all other good friends as you shall have occasion to see them, and lastly, committing you to God, I commend myself to your prayers. Father William Davies. Letter written during his trial. Website, www.thecatholicuniverse.com. Email, joseph.kelly@thecatholicuniverse.com.